مدینہ مال اینڈ ریزیڈنسی. تفصیلات کے لیے رابطہ کیجیے شراز بدر 519-807-8771. ای میل کیجیے shiraz@propertybrothers.com.
Natural sweetener, flavor all. 20 flavors to choose from. The perfect substitute for sugar and artificial sweeteners.
Flavor all by Greenish.
Flavor all from Greenish, now available at Rexall pharmacies.
Welcome to Behind the News. I am Halima Sadia and I am joined by Dr. Sharda and Tahir Aslam Gora in my studio with me. And today the topic of our debate is going to be a political scenario of Canada. We are going to discuss our domestic to our international role and our international news. I welcome you both to the studio.
Thank you very much, Halima ji. First of all, accept my greetings for today. And some people celebrated yesterday, some are celebrating today. So please accept my greetings for the Eid al-Fitr, and same to you, sir.
Thank you.
And Eid to Mubarak, all, sir. And to all our listeners, Eid Mubarak.
Thank you very much.
Eid is a very big event right now around the world. People are celebrating, people are having a lot of exchange of views about that because of the moon and all that. Similarly, we are having that trouble in Canada too.
It was there from the childhood. You see, I have been watching this and meeting my friends, especially in Delhi University when I went. So we had a lot of friends and we used to meet on Eid, and they come to university, celebrate together. And we used to celebrate other festivals also together. It's a tragedy that today every community is on their own. That togetherness, that love, which I used to see during my college life, I think that somewhere I am missing that.
The scientific researchers and scientific world has not affected anything because we are still pretending not to be that scientific. But let's come back to the Canadian scenario and let's discuss about, first of all, the hype of Canadian economy. It is going upwards. So what is your take on that? Is it going upwards, or how far you see that?
You see, first of all, allow me to say that Canadian economy is not an independent economy. If it is going up, it is going up only due to American economy. If something goes wrong with the American economy, we automatically go down. The American economy for the last 3-4 years is at its peak. And always remember that the graph goes up, then stabilized, and always goes down. This is the routine of the economic phase throughout the era. So at this moment, since that economy is going up, so Canadian economy is growing. Canadian economy at this time at its peak. I can say that the minimum unemployment rate, if it is due to the government, that I don't think so. It is naturally, whichever government would have been there, it would have happened, because we are 80% depending upon our trade with America. Although we have lost many countries, we have lost India, we have lost China, we have lost even Europe, that treaty has not been rectified yet. But at the same time, I must say that at this time the economy is good, but the prediction for 2019, although half of the year has gone, and for the 2020 is that it will be only between 2.1%, and perhaps it can go down that also. And that's not a very good sign, because economy means it should continue to grow. Even today I was reading Bank of Canada's report that chances are that they have to raise the interest rate in the coming few months. That only shows because some or the other debt ratio has gone too much. Throughout the world, our debt ratio is the highest in the world. And Bank of Canada is very much worried that if this, we don't control this ratio, economy can fizzle down any moment. So they are very much worried about debt ratio. Let me explain what debt ratio is. Debt ratio is that if we earn $1, our debt ratio should be maximum. The ideal one is between 150 to 165. We are sitting at 178. That means we have maximum debt on us. We have credit debt near about 1.72 trillion dollars on Canadians. So they are worried about it.
So I'll come to you, Tahir, in perspective of seeing Theresa May's congregation with President Trump and Prime Minister Justin Trudeau, and their discussion about world war, its consequences. Of course, it is going to affect the economy also. So what's your take on that?
First of all, I like to add one thing what Dr. Sharda expressed in terms of growing Canadian economy in relation with the United States. He is absolutely right. When United States economy grows, our economy grows as well. But it also depends on our relationship with the United States as well. As we witnessed during the past 2 years, we had kind of a bumps in our relationship in terms of our economic trade. So after that, NAFTA being abolished and a new alliance came into existence. So now I think Canada is doing fine because Trump administration finally is giving us more leverage, as well as we are natural ally to the United States. Though our this Liberal government policies are not according to new administration of the United States. They are quite far from their policies, but still United States consider us a good ally, and this country does not belong to liberals only. This country belongs to everyone. So that's what Americans realize. So now coming to your precise question, I think Trump visit to UK is very important, though his visit is in last days of Ms. Theresa May, and some call in the UK that this is a last nail in Theresa's government. But I see things different. As we have witnessed that President Trump visit to United Kingdom was a very welcoming visit, and you know there were few protests against President Trump. There were many protests supporting President Trump as well. So sort of this thing. In terms of Canada, UK, and USA triangle relationship for raising voice against the atrocities of World War I or World War II, they seem on the same page, I must say.
So let's come back to interprovincial trading, because that we talked about international scenario, that how it is affecting. But if we see within the provinces, there is a lot of difference. There is economical exchanges at a very difficult situation. So how do you see it, Dr. Sab?
Elimaji, if you allow me 1 minute, I would like to make the point about June 5. It's a very important day in the world. This was in 1944, June 5th, when the Allied forces under the commandership of Eisenhower thought of attacking, final attack on the German forces. And that was from the Normandy, which is the sea beach of France. Lacks of forces, yeah, in English, hundreds of thousands of forces, 4,000 aircrafts, and thousands of small and big ships. They went on that day to attack, in which Canadian particular battalion was the first one to go across the sea in Normandy and more than 5,700 Canadians die in one day on that day. So that is a sacrifice. And we know what, one day we will discuss that what was the effect of the Second World War, how it happened and why it happened, whether it can happen again or not. Now coming to the interrelationship of the Canadian states. You know, we have 10 states and we have three union, you can call it union territories. It's a tragedy that we are talking, I mean, since Trudeau has come into power, he's talking about trade, that we want to have trade relationship with India, with China, with Korea, with Europe, with America, with France and everyone. But it is a tragedy that he has not been able to sort out the internal problems of the 13 states in Canada. There is no free trade in Canada. Although they worked few months back and they came up with some solution, but still not. I mean, we are living in 10 different countries that we have to have a treaty with each and every state. This is the role of the federal government to bring everyone together and make it sure that we do trade. It should be a free market for at least Canadians, if not anyone else. Now, Mr. Scheer has stated today that if he becomes the Prime Minister, his first priority will be to remove carbon tax, which is a wastage of money. And second priority, he said, will be that I will give more autonomy to the states. And we will have better relationship with all the states because 7 states are being ruled by conservatives in Canada out of 10.
So let's come back to internal politics. We are having election season. It's the summertime and after that soon we will be having the elections. So how do you see all the parties, where their standing is, as we see that the Green Party is taking another step ahead and they are once again rejuvenating the political scenario. So how do you see every party?
Right now, the political scenario for upcoming elections in Canada, which will be in October 2019, is very interesting to watch. Because two sort of mainstream big parties, conservatives and liberal, they both are tying with each other, but also there is a leadership crisis in both parties. There is not much sort of a difference between liberal and conservatives at the moment. Liberals are already in the center left, and now conservatives are leaning towards center left as well, because under the leadership of Mr. Scheer, they wanted to win election by all means. But what we are getting news from insiders from both parties, some of the old boys and some of the party loyalists in both parties are not happy with the leadership in both parties. In that scenario, NDP could not fill the void because Jagmeet could not create that kind of a charisma and couldn't bring something very innovative. Green Party is getting a little bit more sort of a notice within the Canadian voters. I believe this is because of the protest vote. Right now, Maxime Bernier, I mean, for me, is the best choice because he's a clear man in terms of his ideas. So Maxime's hype is not visible at the moment, but I'm pretty confident that by the end of July, as Maxime going to give a sort of a momentum to the party, and I'm pretty confident that the populist movement would roll Maxime's party in a very thrilling and exciting way.
If I interject at this moment, can you imagine? Just few weeks back, Mr. Carney's name came up for the Liberal Party. He is at this time a governor of the Bank of England. His name started cropping up every day in the newspaper that the inner boys, boys, which we call them, they have started working, bringing Carney to Canada and make him the leader of the Liberal Party. Whereas Mr. Bernier, he is talking about, I totally disagree. He may be having the best ideas, but time is not on his side. That's a tragedy with him. Organization as such needs time, needs money, and needs organizational setup every constituency. And I think that's where he's lacking a lot. Since there are only 3 months, because on 23rd of October, elections take place, the date is fixed. That's number one. Number two, at the same time, 1 month before, 30 days before, election code comes. So we are talking only till July, August. That's all we have. In September, there will be election code. So I don't think, I mean, wonderful ideas, everything is fine. But you have to convey to the people and convince the people and make it sure that your organization is strong. I think that he's lacking a lot, may not be this election, but perhaps for the next 4 years, if he tries, it may be a Conservative Party may ask him to come and take over.
But but I like to add one thing here again. If we just go back to the election 2015, this political scenario was not clear even before 2 months. Even before 2 months of the election, everyone was predicting that the Conservative would be re-elected. And then a situation came just a month before that maybe Conservative would make a minority government. And then we saw sort of a majority government by Liberal. I would say the scenario of Canadian politics would be much clearer closer to the election. And I would say that is the time, honestly tell you, because there is so much mess within the parties, there would be better clear picture in September. And I would say you would never know what would happen by October election because of the leadership crisis in both political parties.
You may be right, but you know it is a very nice idea to dream and think about it. But at the same time, I do realize that these two political parties, Liberal Party and Conservative Party, they have their organization in each and every constituency. Bernier does not have that. Bernier, at this time, I can give you the latest survey which is there. Bernier, of course, has a good number of percentage in Quebec, but otherwise everywhere else, he's nowhere. Absolutely. Whether he can come at that time, no, because he needs some party. Now, Liberal Party is an organized party right from, from 1867 onwards. But at the same time, he has to organize a political party. You have to have an organization, which I think he lacks a lot. I wish, I always said, even at that time when he lost, he did not lose the election. He was made to lose the election, which is a very sad chapter. If he was the Conservative Party leader today, there was no need even to think about it. He would have won hands down because, you see, he would have got 20, 30 seats in Quebec. He would have got the seats in the eastern provinces, and he would have got eastern Ontario. So, he was at that time the best leader. West always comes with the Conservative Party, whosoever is a leader is. But that West wanted to impose their own man. That's what they did. And I think that they may have to pay for it.
So let's come to the apologies. Prime Minister Justin Trudeau is very, there are too many apologies in his pocket right now. So what would you say?
First of all, I would say, it's a nice gesture. There is no harm in it, because if something has been done wrong in the past, you apologize it. But if you make it a political statement out of it, that's where I have the differences with the present Prime Minister. You see, you can apologize, but you cannot make it a political statement. So wherever he went for the Chinese apology, he went for the Japanese apology, he went for the Punjabi Sikh apology, and he went for First Nation apology. That too, after the report has come, the report is of 1,071 pages, which will be, I can assure you, that will be put in one corner, and there will be tons and tons of dust in the next 5-10 years, although he said no, he's going to work on it. I doubt very much, but I think in a way, as long as you don't politicize these things, everything is fine. I mean, you should, if something has happened, if you have done something in the past. He hasn't done it, but the other government did it. So that's not a bad idea, but I just say don't politicize it. What about you, Tahir? Do you think?
No, I mean, I absolutely agree with you, Dr. Sharda. There is so much politicization of those political correct statements. I wouldn't call them apologies. They are actually political correct statements. Mr. Trudeau, as we were talking about Mr. Trudeau's sort of a grant for the third world countries, which is $1 billion almost a year, just for one initiative. I mean, Canada is not like United States. Our economy is not that big that we could spare $2 billion to the rest of the world for the causes which are controversial and which are not clear. So that's the kind of a policies Mr. Trudeau is in sort of placing on Canadians, I would say. So Canadian taxpayer money is going for those causes. Canadians' sentiments are being exploited in those apologies or political correct statements. And this is sort of something which is too much.
It's not a couple of billions, it's 10 billions.
Yeah.
It's a 10 billion.
10 billion for over the period of 10 years.
You know,
no,
10
I'm saying
years.
Like a couple of billion dollars every year.
I mean, this is the 10 billion, and this is for the developing countries where perhaps you will find. They will take the money, and the money will go to the political politician's pocket, because you have no control on
right.
the money once you give it, because those are the most perhaps corrupted countries. We know Africa is the most corrupted country. We know Asia also is most of the corrupted country. You are not going to pay to Europe. You are not going to pay, to America. You are going to pay to the developing countries, which are in Asia, Africa, and perhaps some
right.
some countries in the South America. And South America, you know, being a absolutely Roman Catholics, they are against all these things which he wants to do it. It's a nice gesture, but don't spend public money just like that, and always promise. He, you know, since he has come into power, Tahir, I would like you to comment about it.
Yeah.
He's only promising for the next 10 years, 20
yes.
years, this is what I will do.
Yeah, yeah.
So he's telling the people, give me 10 years,
right.
don't remove me, keep me in seat, I will do all those things which I have told you.
I totally agree with you, Dr. Sharda, because the issue is about the time frame, what he proposes, and that clearly means that he wanted to be a Prime Minister of Canada for another 20 years. Of course, I don't think so. As Canadian myself, our majority of the Canadians want to see him as our Prime Minister for that longer period of time.
This is an endless talk, and we can talk about it for so long, but unfortunately we are out of time right now. I thank you both for being with
Thanks
me
a lot.
Today for the discussion in our studio.
Thanks a lot. Mm-hmm.
Thank you very much for watching Behind the News, and stay tuned with us. We'll bring you more news next time.